Come blast off in my time machine. Third eye feeling like an Evazine. Blast off, blast off, blast off, blast off. Come blast off in my time machine. Third eye feeling like an Evazine. Blast off, blast off, blast off, blast off.
Blast off on the part two deep dive. You guys asked for it. Here it is of the Hero Paranormal Hyper Anomalous Esoteric Research Organization podcast. Hero for short. And there's a bunch of stuff I wasn't able to get to yesterday, and we're going to get to it. Also, keep an eye out today. I have a podcast with the one, the only amazing Chris Matthew of Forbidden Knowledge News. That's going to be a barn burner. Let's get to it. Before we jump all the way in, if you haven't gone to heroparanormal.com, please check it out. Tons of new product over there at the shop. We also have stuff available for sale for the health-minded. Great stuff for your skin, known as Spice Natural Bronze. You can pick that up at happinessmedical.com. Anything you buy there helps support the podcast. Okay, let's dive in. Had a great response to the podcast yesterday, but I've got to dive deeper. You know, I feel like we just barely scratched the surface when it came to these strange Arizona connections, the sanctuary, the resort, the colon detoxifying fecal resort that Hunter Biden went to. I'll do a quick rundown, but if you really, you should watch the original, the part one, to this podcast, and I'll go over it here really quick for those who didn't hear the podcast yesterday. Hunter Biden had a situation in Arizona, a small town near Cornville is the name of it, and he went to a resort. Some have joked it's run by a person named Miss Puma, a very talented detoxification expert. It is a resort that people have jokingly called the poop resort, but in all seriousness, Miss Puma and this location she has is amongst the best of the best in detoxifying people from all kinds of things, foods, drugs, etc. Now, Hunter was on, for lack of a better word, one of his Hunter S. Thompson-like benders. This is, of course, Hunter Biden we're talking about, but I'll go a little bit into the name Hunter. I went deeper yesterday into the name Hunter and what that represents going into the forest of mysteriousness with the hunter, how the hunter can become the hunted. So Hunter had this scenario. It started at a Hertz rental car outlet, and he returned a car with, among the items that were illegal, a bag of cocaine, a crack pipe, a badge from an attorney general, his brother, actually, and Secret Service credentials, all of which he legally and lawfully should not have had. The Hertz rent-a-car called the sheriff. The sheriff came out, arrested him, put him in cuffs, and took him down to the station. Same day, quickly afterwards, he was released. These are the benefits of having a father in power. But what's interesting is he was in this location, Cornville, Arizona, just outside of Sedona, gorgeous valley, and this woman, Miss Puma, is, like I said, amongst the best of the best at detoxifying people. Now you guys are slightly up to speed. Not completely, but slightly up to speed, those who didn't hear the podcast yesterday. Where it gets really interesting is, well, he wrecked a rental car. But let me explain, it's unlike any wreckage. It's more complicated. In fact, esoteric. This I did not cover in yesterday's podcast, and it's very important. On the night in 2016, during a crack-fueled cross-country odyssey that Hunter Biden recalls in his memoir, Beautiful Things, Hunter Biden saw an owl. He had already totaled one rental car that trip. Suddenly, an enormous barn owl swooped over my windshield. as if dropped straight from the inky night sky. It flew in his headlights like a guide along the winding mountain road. And I quote, like a stunt plane at an air show. The meaning of the apparition, which he thinks saved his life, I didn't know if it was real or a hallucination, but it sure as heck woke me up. I think it's actually sure as hell, whatever. Woke me up. So, from the memoir, Beautiful Things, Hunter Biden with this owl. Very interesting indeed. Now, we went into the agenda of toxification of the population, and how the superclass and power elite are aware of the detoxification processes needed to live long and healthy lives, aka Hunter Biden was smart enough to go to a detox facility afterwards. Oh, among the best in the world, if not the best, in this amazing location in Cornville, Arizona, a location where just across the street, the only famous Arizona politician, John McCain, owned a house. So it's obvious that the superclass, power elite, and political powerhouses know where to own real estate. Now, Sedona in general is beautiful. This place is just outside of Sedona called Cornville. Small, small town, 3,500, I believe, the population around that. And let's just say that they know the spots, the hot spots to heal, the hot spots for many things. And speaking of hot spots, Arizona has a lot of paranormal hot spots. And this hot spotting of this owl in Hunter Biden's memoirs is also very esoteric. We're going to go into the spotting of the owl, what that means, and what that means in relation to his drug-fueled adventure. He more or less says this owl may have saved his life. He had already totaled one rental car that trip. You know, very obvious about that explanation. And I've known people who have hit owls in the past. And those are harbingers of bad luck. If you hit an owl in your car, one person I knew, their entire ranch, the full hundreds of acreage, burnt to the ground. And this is something that can be a harbinger of bad luck. Or worse, some claim a harbinger of death. But owls have a lot of representation. We know that owls in the occult and the esoteric have deep meaning. There's a reason why the Bohemian Grove has the all-seeing owl. The all-seeing owl sees all, knows all. It's a symbol of knowledge. In fact, owls can have many esoteric meanings, including wisdom, intuition, and prophecy. In Native American culture, owls can represent wisdom, magic. Some healers believe owls can provide insight into evil intentions. And some First Nations believed their calls could summon the spirit world. Cultural symbolism is important as well, as owls can symbolize inner wisdom, inner change, inner transformation, intuitive development, good luck, and self-actualization. They're also among the top tier of spirit totem or spirit animals. Owls can symbolize the mystery intelligence. Protection. Of course, they can also provide clairvoyance and help people see behind the veil and see beyond the obvious. Owls also have very negative meanings in some cultures and tradition. Biblically, specifically, owls can symbolize destruction, desolation. They make that hooting sound, which is like a groan, and makes emphasis on a cry that sounds toward the ruin. In witchcraft, owls are very important. In Africa, owls can be seen as harbingers of evil and messengers who announce illness or death. The owl is also associated with a form of esoteric knowledge that transcends the limits of rational understanding. Its ability to navigate the darkness of night symbolizes the ability of the human mind to explore the hidden mysteries of existence, and discover profound truths that often elude ordinary perception. Now, owl symbolism when it comes to deity is amazing. The Hindu goddess Lakshmi is represented by an owl who is considered very important. In ancient Greek literature, Hecate is often accompanied by a bunch of owls, reinforcing the bond between the goddess and these wise birds. And because of such association, the bird often referred to as the owl of Athena or the owl of Minerva has been used as a symbol of wisdom and knowledge. Owls are also reportedly a animal that can, well, be associated with screen memories. People who are abducted by quote-unquote aliens consider the owl oftentimes entering their psyche or their memory as a quote-unquote screen memory or a memory that was placed in their mind which never really happened. The owls actually being the alien grays who abducted them, but when they remember what took place, they picture owls instead of those alien entities. In spiritual terms, owls are all about insight, the nocturnal prowess, the ability to discern truth from deception, and those messengers of deception, those alien grays, as people semantically call them, the non-human intelligence, which takes its payment in the form of human abduction. Well, they use owls as a symbolic representation of themselves, according to abductees and contactees, specifically in the form of screen memory placement. Dreams which have owls in them oftentimes have spiritual significance. There are hidden intuitive truths or guidance taking place. The rare occurrence of seeing an owl during the day urges people to, well, be more aware, and while encounters at night have to do more with the unveiling of secrets, the spiritual meanings are there, and Hunter Biden basically conveys this in his memoirs. Specifically on a drug-fueled vision quest of sorts, it's interesting to see this particular bird, which is coming from a species of mostly solitary, nocturnal animals of prey. You see, this has very sharp correlations as far as the esoteric symbolism. Owls fly silently. In other words, people don't know they're there. Yet they are predators with sharp talons, binaural hearing, and binocular vision. They are very dualistic, nocturnal, and solitary, much like the vision quest drug-fueled adventure that people like Hunter Biden, people like Hunter S. Thompson, and others have taken on to endeavor. Those trips down the rabbit hole, right? Indigenous elders often describe owls as monsters of the night. When it appears, it foretells things. Oftentimes, nothing but evil. Owls have, well, observational skills. They are swift hunters. Again, this hunter alliteration, this hunter meaning, this Hunter S. Thompson, this Hunter Biden, the hunter's moon, as I talked about in Leave the World Behind, the moon that took the life of Matthew Perry, who was in Friends. Of course, Friends was alluded to in the movie Leave the World Behind. And of course, Matthew Perry died on the birthday of his ex-girlfriend, Julia Roberts, who also starred in the movie Leave the World Behind. The dualistic qualities, these synchronicities, the escort into the occult is the owl. So it's very interesting that the owl would have properties of the hunter. The hunter sometimes is the monster of the night. So it's weird that we have so much hunter meaning, hunter symbolism, Owls are often overwhelming, otherworldly. They defy the rules of nature, silent but deadly. They contradict. They see all 360 degrees. Interestingly, owls, in the case of alien abductions, are not what they seem, not what they appear to be. And in David Lynch's 1990s cult television series, Twin Peaks, owls are involved. There were multiple plots, but the atmosphere of the show included strange supernatural elements. It was a strange, kind of quirky show. If you haven't got into it, you really kind of need to, because owls echo throughout the series, and they play on that duality that I mentioned. Owls are dualistic. Owls are not what they seem. Owls are there oftentimes to show other possibilities, to show an eeriness, to show folklore is real. Owls are messengers from the underworld, and the Mayans believed this. If you read the narratives of the Popol Vuh, one of my favorite readings, you'll see that this mytho-historical narrative is rife with owl symbology. Hunter S. Thompson, Hunter Biden, the Hunter's Moon. The owl is a hunter, a swift hunter, which, let's get real, it taunts unsettling behaviors. It mocks physics and the reality of the vertebrae. Owls can twist their head around. Although it appears to be 360 degrees, it's only scientifically proven to be 270 degrees. But the truth is, they do see all. They mock reality. They hold every vantage point at once, all seeing, omnipresent. The head swivel alone is a force in defiance of nature. Much like Hunter Biden's defiance of nature, mocking reality, mocking the status quo, defiance of the rules that be, depraved and decadent adventures. Hunter concluded that he was the guy to push the boundaries, because who else is going to do it? He was in a position, right? He was into this dangerous gamble. Everything to lose and no fear to lose it. Let's face it. He got wasted a lot, took drugs, went on psychedelic adventures, and when he woke up the next day, oftentimes, he would probably think to himself, what in the world took place? Much like Hunter S. Thompson. Hunters of the strange. Hunters of the gonzo. Remember gonzo journalism? God knows why these individuals, these hunters of the fringe, doing anything they can to peek over the edge of reality. Now, God knows why, but Hunter S. Thompson brought the word gonzo to reality. You can't explain the word gonzo. It's a phenomena that happens in the world, in the moment. Appreciation of the now, a threat to the status quo. Gonzo. And let's just say that when many people don't realize who Hunter S. Thompson really was, his hit, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, was based on real events. Thompson had been writing a story for the Rolling Stone about the murder by Los Angeles County Sheriff's deputies of a Mexican-American journalist. The story is called Strange Rumblings in Atzlan. A radical Chicano lawyer, Oscar Zeta Acosta, was involved in defending several cases of defendants who were being targeted by law enforcement and the courts. Needless to say, the pressure was getting to him. When Hunter S. Thompson started and accepted this assignment by Sports Illustrated to write a brief article about a dirt bike rally or race in Vegas, this attorney, Acosta, said he'd come along with him. They both were experts at excess. They were bound to get in trouble together. This is how they bonded. How much trouble they got into isn't exactly clear, but they did. Thompson said that his book was 75% true. He was not going to say it was 100% true. Of course, that book, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, mentions adrenochrome. Thompson wrote the book. It was published in two installments in the Rolling Stone. And he used the crediting term of the author, Raoul Duke, because he needed the money. He often said he disliked his job. He disliked writing, but he did appreciate the adventures. And his adventures in Vegas must have seemed like convenient material, easy to write about. He was there, first person. There was a serious purpose to the book. Hunter S. Thompson felt that he had a lot of good that he saw in the United States. Of course, he was also aware of the shadow, the lots and lots of dark in the United States. And in Fear and Loathing, which he subtitled A Savage Journey to the Heart of the American Dream, think about that subtitle for a moment, A Savage Journey to the Heart of the American Dream, he said that it seemed like a hopeless quest, as he believed it, was all but gone, and he hated to see it gone. Hunter S. Thompson was from a different era. And I would argue that he and Hunter Biden have a lot in common. Narcissistic personalities. They are very intelligent. They know how to undermine others. They design their emotional, mental, and physical well-being around indulgence. And they are forces to be reckoned with, both of them. Hunters of a different cloth, albeit the same trajectory. Guys whose boundary-setting apparatus is broken. Boundaries don't exist. They are designed to adventure out past the status quo, out past the boundaries of modern society, and delve deeply into the shadow work involved with psychedelics and the adventures which they reap benefits from, although not entirely sure how they utilize those benefits, but in the case of Hunter S. Thompson, he used those benefits to write amazing novels. Now, I recently heard some stuff about Hunter S. Thompson that really kind of made me not like him. Not that I was a huge fan in the first place. You know, he does mention things like adrenochrome in Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, but this was a little bit darker. Got a question coming in from a listener on one of the platforms. I'll get right to it. It turns out Hunter S. Thompson, well, seriously, was cruel to animals. He abused them. Girlfriends have spoken about this. And although he is very important in the new journalism movement, he was very mean to animals. Very cruel to animals. He would kick cats of his girlfriends. And he didn't care. He blurred the lines of reality. And maybe it was his drug-influenced behavior. But I don't really like people that abuse animals for whatever reason. And, you know, this just really kind of put a bad taste in my mouth that the guy runs around kicking his girlfriend's cats and his own animals and basically didn't care, right? And some argue, you know, that that's what it is. An interesting quote of his was, if a guy wants to beat his wife and his dog bites him, well, that's between the three of them. Interesting quote. If a guy wants to beat his wife and his dog bites him, that's between the three of them. Very strange, Hunter. And he was, in fact, involved, at least in conspiratorial terms, according to some, in some interesting ordeals regarding the Bohemian Grove and potential trafficking of children and potential abuse of children. I'll get into that. These are allegations that are all over the internet having to do with Hunter S. Thompson. Okay, so the question from the listener, before I forget, why is Johnny Depp so enthralled and intrigued by Hunter S. Thompson, and why were they such good friends? Well, let's keep in mind that Johnny Depp was accused of domestic abuse by Amber Heard. They have a lot of things in common when it comes to the types of friends they have, and they did become fast friends. They specifically have interest in the occult, the esoteric, drugs, of course, alcohol, and psychedelics. So they're both very exotically influenced individuals. I think that's why they are so fast to hang out together, fast to be friends. Of course, Johnny Depp was studying Hunter S. Thompson, so it was his job to be enthralled by him, to act in the silver screen version of Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. But yeah, they have a lot of similarities. Great question from the listener. All right, so getting back to Hunter S. Thompson abusing animals, talking about very strange things, and the accusations that he had something to do with child trafficking, possibly child abuse of a sexual nature, connections to the Bohemian Grove. Let's dig in a little. Let's dig our heels into this and pull into this rabbit hole with care, with a tether, because you can go right down it. It's a slippery slope. And I'm going to start on the periphery of this before we go into the childhood Bohemian Grove child sex stuff. Okay. So Thompson was with a few friends, 8,000 feet up in the Rockies, a few miles from Aspen, Colorado, when he was 52 years old, in a log-built house that set the stage for some interesting events. He was with a woman named Gail Palmer Slater. Okay, this is where things get strange. She came from Michigan with a letter, and she said to have included a tape of pornographic video she once produced. But let's get to the good stuff. Thompson was with some of his friends when she arrived. The night went on. Some of his friends left. And she told authorities later that Thompson suggested she join him in a hot tub session. When she said no, she said that he threw his vodka and cranberry juice at her. Then he grabbed her left breast and twisted it hard. "Get out of here," he shouted, using profane language. All kinds of, I won't list it. It's listed here. But anyway, the woman ran to the porch and called a taxi. Early that morning, she told authorities what had happened. Now, interestingly enough, the district attorney in Colorado's 9th Judicial Court went with a search warrant looking for evidence of the assault and or illicit drugs. Investigators took with them the broken cranberry juice bottle, a paper towel soaked with pink liquid, suspected drug paraphernalia, pills, and a small amount of white powdery substance, some leafy green material, a few sticks of dynamite, a jar of mushrooms, and a tape labeled child porn. Moving on, Hunter S. Thompson was a very controversial author and allegedly linked to Larry King, who was a person who allegedly was implicated in Paul Bonacci's testimony and where a pedophile victim revealed that Hunter S. Thompson directed a graphic snuff film. Now, I need to make sure that this is all linked up to the Bohemian Grove, and this is not the Larry King that was a radio show personality. It's another Larry King that was implicated in Paul Bonacci's testimony, where this victim of pedophilia revealed that Thompson directed a graphic snuff film. Of course, a snuff film is one where somebody's killed. This was made near Sacramento, California, at a location called, get this, the Bohemian Grove. So Bonacci, that's Paul Bonacci's testimony, Bonacci flew numerous times across state lines for sexual exploitation to Washington, D.C. and other cities, and he testified on videotape in 1990 for Nebraska State Police investigator Gary Caradori. Here, Bonacci said that while he was on a trip to Sacramento to the Bohemian Grove, he was forced at gunpoint to commit homosexual acts on another boy before he watched other men do the same, after which the boy was shot in the head. This is very eerily similar to Ryan Garcia, you know, the boxer, and the story that he came up with and alleged that, you know, stuff happened to him at Bohemian Grove. Some have said it's been debunked. Others aren't quite sure. The fact is, you never know with Ryan Garcia, but eerily similar. Now, in separate testimony, Bonacci told that Larry King, this gentleman, Larry King was smiling and laughing the whole time the film was being shown. People were watching, and there was a lot of abuse, right? Sexually abusing kids, boys. Now, there is a guy named Rusty Nelson who talks about being offered $100,000 to make a pedophilia snuff film for Thompson. This is really weird because Rusty, aka Russell E. Nelson, was arrested 2 days after journalist Hunter S. Thompson reportedly committed suicide. Very strange. Now, according to phone interviews with an attorney named John DeCamp, Nelson was allegedly employed by a former Republican Party activist. He was employed to take pictures of U.S. House Senate members and other prominent government officials who were engaged in sexual criminality. So it's a honeypot situation regarding sex acts, sodomy, children during the Reagan-Bush administrations. A honeypot like Epstein's. And Hunter S. Thompson, there were a lot of different people who testified that he was kind of, you know, dabbled into this stuff. He would dip his toes into the pool of pedophilia, but from a voyeuristic standpoint. But this is an entirely different ordeal. And very strange that sometimes the hunter can become the hunted. Makes you wonder what exactly was behind Hunter S. Thompson's suicide. Regardless, Hunter S. Thompson's death and the news of Rusty Nelson, basically at the same time, his simultaneous arrest, right, around the same time that Hunter S. Thompson committed suicide, raises a lot of questions. Now, again, I have to clarify that this this person who was involved with Hunter S. Thompson and this whole ordeal, this Larry King, is not the same Larry King who is an American author, does movies, does radio shows. Not the same Larry King. A lot of people, you know, think it's the same Larry King. Not the same Larry King. This Larry King is a very different Larry King who had a long history of, well, trafficking, strange honeypot like scenarios and was involved with a lot of strange endeavors. So let me go into this Larry King a little bit. This gentleman that was implicated by Paul Bonacci's testimony, who was the pedophile victim, this Larry King, was a very controversial individual. And many conspiracy theories have come out of this and spread after the information coming from Larry King. So he, it seems, and others, prominent citizens, were involved with a high-level child prostitution ring with alleged abuse victims who were interviewed. And this went from the East Coast of the United States to the West Coast of the United States. And these accusations came from all over the place. Lavish parties at which minors were sexually abused, allegedly. And there was also people involved from Washington, D.C. There was a specific house in D.C. where allegedly these things would transpire. Many, many conspiracy theories spread. Conspiracy theories about the alleged abuse being part of a widespread series of crimes, including devil worship, cannibalism, drug trafficking, and CIA arms dealings. So there really is no definitive proof, unfortunately, but there is a lot of foul stench coming out of these theories. Many of the accusers have actually gotten in trouble, believe it or not, which is strange. Two of the original accusers were indicted on perjury charges. They called it a carefully crafted hoax and baseless claims. They claimed that they were padding the information, adding things they shouldn't have added. I could go on and on about this individual, Larry King, but I don't want to get derailed from Hunter S. Thompson, because this is, we're talking about the Hunters here, right? Hunter Biden, Hunter Thompson. And there's some really interesting things about the Hunters. One is Hunter got in a gunfight with his neighbor. This is Hunter S. Thompson, that is. And he made the following quote while in this gunfight with a neighbor. He said, "In a democracy, you have to be a player." Very strange. Now, this was an actual gunfight between himself and a neighbor where they were shooting guns at each other. Now, one might assume that this is not the type of behavior that is considered cool, but we run into this over and over again with Hunter S. Thompson, where he does completely irrational things and people say, "Oh, that's cool." I don't know why that is, but it is. It's just the fact. You have those Hunter S. Thompson groupies that will never give up on the guy. And in this remote and secluded location, you would think that there wouldn't be any type of possibility for a conflict with neighbors, but with Thompson, there was. He has footage out on the internet of this confrontation, and you can see him exchanging gunfire with a newly arrived resident over some sort of dispute having to do with livestock. If this SOB wants to be ITCH about his cows over here and shoot at me, well, it's our country. It's not theirs. It's not a bunch of used car dealers from Southern California, all the while returning gunfire. Extremely reckless. But this behavior is sort of organically Thompson, right? This is organically accepted by the people who follow Hunter S. Thompson as, well, this is kind of what happens when you're with people like Hunter S. Thompson. Which, you know, begs the question, what doesn't happen when you're with Hunter S. Thompson? Would that also involve child sex trafficking rings, snuff films, people being sexually abused at lavish parties, meaning minors being sexually abused at lavish parties? Now, there's a strange connection to Nebraska and this Larry King guy. There was a huge amount of money involved with carefully crafted, embezzlement schemes. And there's also, interestingly, another Alicia Owen was another victim who, or I should say alleged victim, who was imprisoned on 8 counts of perjury. She served 4.5 years in prison. A federal grand jury concluded that the abuse allegations were unfounded, and they indicted this 21-year-old Alicia Owen to 4.5 years in prison. Recently, a lot of people have been helping her get her story out. Now, the same federal grand jury later indicted King and multiple officers of a credit union with embezzlement of funds. In fact, King pled guilty to assisting in embezzling $39 million and was sentenced to 15 years in prison. In spite of the findings of the grand jury, Paul Bonacci, a witness who was also charged by the grand jury but not ultimately convicted, filed a civil suit against King the same year. Bonacci won the case after King failed to defend himself, leading the judge to award a default judgment. So Bonacci got some money out of this. Now, interestingly, this is where things get crazy. What does this all have to do with these strange pornography rings and the Bohemian Grove? Well, DeCamp, a former Nebraska state senator and decorated Vietnam War vet, told that there were tons of pictures left, meaning law enforcement is currently looking for them, adding the following. You can also assume that there are senators and congressmen implicated. Otherwise, this would not be such a big issue. But no federal official has stepped forward to protect some of these individuals. One of those is Rusty Nelson. Rusty Nelson's life is what they're talking about in this particular case, as Congress would be reluctant to hold hearings or force a federal prosecutor to probe its own members for sex acts with children, still punishable by law. So, did it happen, right? This gentleman, this victim, Paul Bonacci, says he was kidnapped and forced into sex slavery between the ages of 6 and 17. What's strange is we have other victims claiming the same stuff, and we're talking about 20,000 to 30,000 pictures in some of these probes. It really makes you wonder what was taking place. You know, were there sex parties between adult men and other adult men, but most of it had to do with young boys and young girls? Well, it seems that some of these parties, some of which were in Washington, D.C., there were a lot of parties there, that these might be future senators and congressmen. But then again, others claim this is all far-fetched. But of course, one story claims Hunter Thompson was there. He saw the abuse, may have had a part in it, and then was involved with the snuffing or killing of an individual, a young boy. Another one saw it. It was recorded. So there is a snuff film out there. I mean, these are really, really dark rabbit holes, specifically when it comes to the sex with minors. Now, there's so much info. It's easy to get lost in the weeds. I can get my lanes crossed here. There's so much going on. But there is one very important character in all this, which is John David Gosch. Okay? This is basically a paperboy in West Des Moines, Iowa, who disappeared on September 5th, 1982. It was presumed that he was kidnapped. He had his picture featured on the milk carton. In fact, he was among the first to have his picture featured on a milk carton. If you're my age, you know that this is how they used to let people know or alert people that kids were missing. They would put their picture on a milk carton. That was the campaign to find missing children. His mother, Noreen Gosh, said that Johnny escaped from his captors and visited her with a mystery man, an unidentified gentleman, in 1997. She said that her son told her that he had been the victim of a pedophile ring. Things get weirder from there, as if it's not super strange already. Now, he said that he subsequently feared for his life and he lived under an assumed identity. Gosh's father, his name was John, divorced his mother in 1993. His father has publicly stated that he is not sure whether such a visit actually occurred. Many have also said that maybe the visit did happen, but it was someone else pretending to be Johnny. Interestingly enough, authorities have not located or confirmed Noreen Gosh's account. The case received a lot of publicity in 2006 when his mother said she had found photographs on her doorstep with Gosh in captivity, tied up. Some of the photos received were said to be children from a case in Florida. But one of the boys in the photos was never identified. His mom, Noreen, insists that boy is Johnny. Bear with me as we go out onto a very strange branch of conspiracy. Anyone who's heard the theories surrounding Johnny Gosh and his disappearance in 1982 knows that a lot of these theories are difficult to accept. But is it possible? Some claim Johnny still lives, that he's still around. Private investigators have looked into this, and in 1999, remember, Bonacci won a $1 million lawsuit against Larry King, the former head of the Franklin Credit Union scandal. Now, he claimed that Larry forced him into the pedophile ring. Gets even stranger, because there are subliminal hints revolving around all of this. And this is the Hunter Thompson snuff films. The strange connection between Johnny Gosh and Jeff Gannon. Okay, so this is where it gets really weird. You remember the Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, where they take on a passenger in Nevada in the back seat and the guy's scared to death of them? Well, it's something similar to that. But let's get into the ins and outs of all this. Few people would have ever connected Hunter Thompson and Johnny Gosh, but those who are familiar with the conspiracy tales of child abuse and pedophilia documented in the Franklin Cover-Up, a book first released in 1994 by Senator John DeCamp, understand how these interconnect. In the book, DeCamp relates discussions with Paul Bonacci, the one who sued Larry King and got the $1 million, the young man who claims to have been involved with the kidnapping of Johnny Gosh. Bonacci told wild stories, being forced to sex with adults and other children. In one case, he recalls being flown into Nevada with another young boy who he wasn't familiar with. They took on another passenger and headed to a secluded location where Bonacci says he was forced to have sex with the younger boy. Dark stuff. Now, the young boy, Bonacci claims in his book, was also forced to have sex with the adult males, who then killed the boy with a gunshot to the head. Bonacci says he was then forced to have sex with the corpse. Pretty dark stuff. Now, the passenger they took on in Nevada filmed the entire thing and Bonacci recalled that his name was Hunter Thompson. I think it's kind of strange that Hunter Thompson would commit suicide later, says a gentleman named Gunderson. Gunderson is going to come into play here in just a moment. So, in light of Paul Bonacci's testimony regarding the snuff film, the timing of this individual's death, meaning Hunter S. Thompson, was interesting. The snuff film that Thompson allegedly made with Paul Bonacci is believed, based on Bonacci's description of the surroundings, to have been filmed at Bohemian Grove, a summer camp of sorts of the rich and powerful. Bohemian Grove always seems to be the place where people claim this stuff happens, whether it does or not, as in the case of Ryan Garcia, the boxer. Sorry, can't talk today. But it is a secluded area outside of Sacramento. Of course, it is a place where world leaders and dignitaries meet for neo-pagan activities, including mock human sacrifices, before a large owl referred to as Moloch. It is known as the Cremation of Care, where participants dress in druid robes and chant before the owl. So here we have the owl symbolism again, similar to the owl that Hunter Biden saw on his drug-fueled vision quest in Arizona near Cornville. Again with the owls. This is all synchronistic. So is it possible that the photographer, a gentleman named Rusty Nelson, claimed that he once turned down an offer of $50,000 from Hunter S. Thompson to help in the production of a snuff film. So here we have another allegation of Hunter S. Thompson being involved with snuff films. There's a few of these. Now, the offer was allegedly made because Nelson worked closely with Larry King, the central figure in the Franklin cover-up. He's the one accused of running a pedophile and child slavery ring. Rusty Nelson testified in court that he participated as a photographer, but claims that he took compromising photos. He never took any hardcore pornographic pictures. He absolutely refused any involvement with child pornography. But he did claim that King employed a Nelson lookalike for this purpose, somebody who looked like him, in order to compromise him. Nelson said tens of thousands of photos were taken. Some say 20 to 30,000. Those were confiscated and either destroyed or permanently sealed to protect those depicted in the honeypot. But according to some, the allegation is that many remain hidden to keep them honest, if you know what I mean. Crazy conspiracy prevails here. Now, despite all these denials, Nelson has served time for his photography work. He was arrested in Oregon years and years ago. And, there were photos. Yeah, he was in a van, and there were photos. He had a van full of photos. Photos that, at least one of which, was said to involve a minor engaged in less than legal activity, as it was put. He had been living in Nebraska, providing whatever information he could to private investigators, trying to put his life back together. But he did do time for taking these photos. Then Hunter S. Thompson committed suicide 2 days before this. 2 days before, Nelson was rounded up by the police and arrested, reportedly for failing to register as a sex offender in a county which he was no longer a resident. So that's kind of strange. He was rounded up by police and arrested 2 days after Hunter S. Thompson's suicide and death, for not registering, but he's no longer a resident of the county in which he was supposed to register. Doesn't make sense to many. So John DeCamp, another player, bailed Nelson out of jail and says he thinks the arrest was intended as a warning to him and others that they keep their mouths shut. Many agree on this point. This is a big deal. The timing is what's so interesting. As one person put it, why? Why the timing? Is it a renewed interest in the Johnny Gosch case? That kid who was on the milk carton. Johnny Gosch may have hit too close to home and threatened to expose others who wanted secrets kept. Okay, so here we have all these ties. Dozens of people, dozens of children, people convicted of fraud totaling $38 million and sentenced to 15 years in prison in the case of King. We have King, a one-time McGovern Democrat who had been the leader of a national black Republican council and a rising star in the GOP. We're talking about a guy who sang the national anthem during the 1984 National Convention. We also have Senator, Nebraska Senator, that is, John DeCamp, who came out with the book, The Franklin Cover-Up, in 1992. The same guy that bailed out Rusty Nelson. Is this starting to make sense? So, there are dozens of conspiracies that come out from these. Some of the longest criminal trials in Nebraska history. And if it is all a hoax, as some people allege, it is one of the most carefully crafted hoaxes since the beginning of time. Consider the following facts here. One gentleman, Caradori, and his 8-year-old son were killed when his private plane exploded in midair in the spring of 1990. He had connections to the case. Okay. The following fact. Journalist Nick Bryant spent 7 years investigating the events of Omaha and interviewing people involved. His book, The Franklin Scandal, confirms DeCamp's findings and conclusions. Take this into account. A British documentary from Yorkshire Television called Conspiracy of Silence was made about the scandal in 1993. It was set to air on the Discovery Channel the night of May 3, 1994, when Yorkshire Television was compensated $500,000 for the hour-long documentary. They were paid off, and it never aired in the United States. No explanation given. Back to these DC connections, a lobbyist named Craig Spence committed suicide in November of 1989 while under investigation for a gay prostitution and blackmail ring. Among other things, Spence made Washington Times front page news on June 29th the year for his off-hour tours of the White House with gay prostitutes. Nick Bryant confirmed a relationship between Spence and Larry King through both Paul Bonacci and, guess who, Rusty Nelson. All these inconvenient synchronicities take place, revolving around the entire Franklin scandal, Hunter S. Thompson, Larry King, CIA assets. And speaking of CIA assets, DeCamp was no stranger to dirty government tricks. Before he died, his ultimate solution to what he had seen was described as a widespread corruption. Similar to living in a very small town where people knew each other and the rule of law still applied. You remember the movie Sicario? This is incidentally the same advice offered by the CIA asset Benicio del Toro to the FBI agent Emily Blunt in the movie. Interestingly enough, Benicio del Toro is also the actor who synchronistically is in Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, which of course is about Hunter S. Thompson. Just a coincidence. He plays the attorney, Dr. Gonzo, the one who drove the red convertible across the Mojave Desert to Las Vegas with a suitcase full of drugs. So it seems that unofficially, it was just all a bunch of strange, frayed ends that didn't connect. But officially, it was a coordinated cover-up. If you're any type of conspiracy theorist at all, you would realize that. DeCamp seems to me that he was a pretty nice guy. In fact, he was a Vietnam veteran, and his mentor was CIA Director William Colby, creator of Operation Phoenix. By far, DeCamp and the investigator Gary Caradori discovered the most information. All the kids' stories, a web of child prostitution in a foster care system, which included the loaning out of children from nearby boys towns. Of course, Boys Town is the same Catholic charity that had access and cash reserves of $500 million by the 1990s, making it the richest square mile in the world, according to Times Bulletin editor Brian Hess. So we have wild, wild coincidences and synchronicities in this conspiracy-riddled arena. We have two hunters, Hunter S. Thompson and Hunter Biden. And interestingly enough, this is a statement that is pretty interesting coming from, Hunter Biden. He said, after this gun trial, "They think you're scared I would shoot you," Hunter added to his sister-in-law, referring to federal law enforcement. And I quote, "You now have me as an abusive pedophile with homicidal tendencies," Hunter went on to say, "and that's now in the hands of the FBI. Very strange comment coming from Hunter Biden. But it is interesting with all the laptop conspiracy that these hunters seem to be interested in, at least peripherally involved in, some of the same things. These vision quests, these drug-fueled vision quests into the unknown, adventures to the fray. I just had to dig a little deeper for some of you because some of you asked me to after yesterday's podcast. I hope this one clarifies some of the strange synchronicities having to do with hunters going deep into the woods of the unknown. Nothing can be proven. Everything can be alleged. And yeah, it's great, great stuff for conspiracy theory. But really, we have to stick to the facts and just realize there's a lot more going on, even in the factual arena, than anyone could ever surmise. You don't have to make things up when there's so many strange synchronicities. Until next time, keep your eyes to the skies, feet on the ground, but don't forget to take a look around. And if you have a chance, head on over to heroparanormal.com. Please subscribe via YouTube. And thank you for listening. Have a very blessed Sunday.
Follow me with your darkest eyes. Follow me with your shape-shifting smiles, and I see you. Maybe they'll believe you. Illuminati occult on trial, silver discs and hidden files, and we see you. We've got a